Today on Mike Attempts, replacing cells in battery packs. In a previous video, I balanced the cell voltage in these old battery packs. One worked great, but it's already down to 3 bars after the first recharge. This one showed a full 4 bar charge, but lasted less than a minute in my drill before showing completely empty. After recharging, I only get a single flashing bar. These packs came in a kit with this drill that I bought almost 17 years ago. 4 Torx TS10 security screws, and we're in. Even though there's still some life left in this pack, I figured it would be a good opportunity to compare soldering against spot welding when rebuilding the packs with new cells. With my multimeter set to measure up to 9 volts DC, I checked each cell. The front cell is the lowest at 3.75. Fully charged, they should be 4.2 volts. The front cell on the dead pack is also the lowest at 1.42. Anything below 2.5 volts likely has permanent internal damage. Any negative readings are just because the positive multimeter probe is on the negative side of the cell and the negative probe is on the positive side. If possible, I'd like to reuse the metal tabs, so I'm going to try to gently break the spot welds using these flush cutters. I started by using the sharp tips to pry up the tabs on the negative side. Then I was able to grab the tab and roll it back. Don't be rough or get in a hurry. Lithium-ion batteries can violently catch fire if the cell is punctured or short-circuited, so be careful. On the positive side, the outside edge that's covered in the colored plastic is negative. If you cut through that plastic covering and the metal part of your tool touches the positive center and the negative edge at the same time, it would create a direct short that could cause the cell to explode due to thermal runaway. I accidentally squeezed a little too hard and cut off the end of the tab. The first one's out. I repeated the process for the remaining cells. Even if some cells were still good and I could find the same exact replacements, these packs are really old, so it's a good idea to replace them all. If not, it won't be long until you're replacing the next dead cell. The positive side of the middle cell has a temperature sensor. Each slot has a plus or minus on the side so you know how to insert the new cells. I used thin needle nose pliers to unroll and flatten the metal tabs. I clipped off the tips of 3 tabs, but only this one needs to be repaired. Not surprisingly, the original Samsung 13Q cells weren't available anymore. So I went with the Samsung 30Q. I got 10 for just under $40 shipped. They have identical specs except that the 30Q is 3000 mAh instead of the original 1300, so the rebuilt packs will be 3 amp hour. The nominal voltage is 3.6. Multiply that by 5 cells and we get our 18 volts. I thought it was important to keep the maximum continuous discharge at 15 amps because I assumed that's all the battery pack circuitry was built to handle. They came charged to 3.45 volts. My original plan was to solder everything, but I gave in and picked up this spot welder on sale for $35. I went with the 8,000 watt foot pedal model. It has an internal battery that's recharged with a wall plug. I really wanted to just crank it up to full power and go for it, but then I thought it'd probably be a good idea to test it out first. I know, boring, but I like my face. I started on number 1, and it barely stuck the nickel strips together. So I went to 3. I'm not scared, you're scared. One of the tips burned right through both pieces. I tried 3 again and got a better result, but still too weak. Let's try 5. A strong weld with no burn through. I'll test it on an old cell just to be sure. I think 5 is the winner. I'll solder the first pack, and if I make any mistakes, I can chuck it into the gravel at the slightest sign of danger. Before beginning, I need to fix this tab. I cut a thin piece of nickel strip and used an aluminum soldering clip to hold it in place. And it's done. I forgot to hit record. For the best bond, I used some fine sandpaper to scuff up the terminals. I wiped it clean and added a drop of liquid flux. I have my iron set to 450 Celsius, and I'm using a wider tip for better heat transfer. I melted a blob of lead-free solder to the tip and transferred it to the negative terminal. You only want the iron touching the battery for the shortest time possible, under 2 seconds maximum. The cell shouldn't even get warm. I did the same on the negative terminal for each one. Then I went back and did the positive terminals. I double-checked the polarity and dropped in the first cell. I added a drop of flux, tinned the tip of the iron, and touched it to the metal tab. It quickly melted the solder beneath. It's ugly, but secure. The other side looks a tiny bit better. I continued soldering while alternating the polarity of each cell. I'm definitely no pro, and I'm sure there are things I could be doing different to get better solder joints. But this method quickly became frustrating. Sometimes the metal tabs want to lift up between removing the iron and the solder solidifying. I even tried holding them down with a bamboo skewer. Little peaks of solder are also forming as I lift the iron. This liquid flux works well, but it's very sticky. Once I thought I was done, I found 2 loose connections that needed to be resoldered. There was an unexpected benefit to the flux. The temperature sensor stuck right on. No lights at all. It seems completely dead. The added thickness of the solder made it difficult to reassemble the case. I ended up having to use the flush cutters to trim off the high spots. Then I was able to squeeze it in. Because it's dangerous to charge cells that are below 2 volts, some brands could have a safety feature which bricks the pack if all cells are removed. Still nothing. Let's slap it on the charger and hope for the best. This is the original charger that came in the drill kit with these battery packs. Well, it seems to be charging. I kept an eye on it throughout. And it looks like it worked. One down, one to go. I'm hoping to learn from my mistakes to avoid clipping off any tabs. I gently pried up the ends and rolled them back. You want to pull up just slightly while rolling to pop the spot welds. I paid close attention not to squeeze the cutters too hard, and I didn't cut a single tab this time. After unrolling, I squished the tabs flat. I cleaned up the new cells and started spot welding. This is so much easier. Most spot welders sense when the tips make contact and then fire automatically. I prefer the pedal because I can take my time lining up the tips and then trigger the weld with my foot. I only had 2 that didn't weld properly on the first try. Not too bad for a beginner. It looks much better than the first pack. No lights on this one either. But after a full charge, it's good to go. Feel free to rate this video, add your comments and questions below, and subscribe for more.